Hi, I'm Michelle Whitmore for the Photographer Academy, and today we're going to be looking at extreme macro photography. Macro photography is generally a one-to-one ratio. This type of photography takes it that step further. I'm going to be using this demonstration the Canon 65 MPE macro lens, which goes up to a 5x magnification. I'm going to be using a ring flash, as it allows us to get in closer to the subjects without creating shadows. And the camera is going to be mounted on a sliding rail so that we can move progressively towards the subject evenly. First, I'm going to meter the light, and then when I take the first image, I will be using the shutter release so as to prevent any camera shake. Alright, so I've metered that and it's reading 16 5/10. So that's a bit bright, so I'm going to need to dial down the flash. This ring flash has two bulbs, so we have to make sure we do it on both bulbs to produce an even light. And we'll see what we get from that. We now get a reading of f11, which is a little bit more acceptable, so that's what we'll dial in. As per the previous studio session, I should be shooting on ISO 100 and on 1/25. I'll also be changing the camera settings to JPEG, and the reason I'm doing that is because of the software that I use to stack. It doesn't have the facility to convert RAWs into JPEGs. So because we're actually stacking, I shall do everything in JPEG to start with. So now we're on large JPEGs, 1/25 at f11 on ISO 100. We're now ready to take our first shot. I'm using a 1p coin and I'm using the reverse side of it, and we're going to concentrate on the corner of the portcullis. To avoid touching the camera, I should be using a shutter release throughout. Now we're going to do a 2:1 magnification. As the lens is now closer to the coin, the focus has changed. So to be able to get that flat plane, I now move the camera along the body through using the focusing rail. As you can see, it's moving slowly and slowly towards the coin until it's lined up. And I will need to adjust the settings on this as the camera gets closer to the coin. Obviously, the light changes somewhat and I need to make those various adjustments. And obviously, this is just for demonstration purposes. This is the 3:1 magnification image. This is the 4:1 magnification image. And this is the final image, which is 5:1 magnification. So that's a small demonstration of the Canon 65 MPE lens and its capabilities, and shows the difference in each of the images between the 1:1 magnification right the way through to the 5:1 magnification. And I think this is a good example of the differences between macro photography and extreme macro photography. Now we'll go and do something a little bit more exciting and look at a housefly.
Trying to make it look as real as possible can sometimes be a little bit awkward. And there it is. And on occasions like this, it's important not to have the windows open and any sort of breeze, because the slightest knock and that's all over. Now we've got to try and get the camera into position so we can see the fly.
As you can see, we've now positioned the fly with my magic tweezers. We've added a background of a dead leaf using one of the plants as an extra hand,
And we're now going to take a series of images of the fly to stack later. This particular lens takes an image on one particular focal plane. So to build up any depth to a picture, we have to take the series of images, which is what we're going to do now. As I explained earlier on, for each of these, I'm going to use the shutter release so that I'm not touching the camera in any way, creating any camera shake. I've already set the first shot up, so we'll go with it. Right, so we have the camera set at 100 ISO on 1/25th again, and we have a f-stop of 3.5. So that's the first of our stacked images. I'm now going to work through the fly until I get to the back of the head, and each time I'm going to move the lens down the rail so we can build up that stacked set. All I'm doing is moving the rail closer and closer to the fly. I'm allowing the flash to recharge each time. It's very important that you have fresh batteries in on this, because you do go through batteries like wildfire. I'm moving the rail at a quarter turn on each occasion, just to keep the evenness of the distance moved between each image. I don't actually need to look through the eyepiece each time, because I'm looking at the image that's flashing on the back of the camera each time. So I can see that the exposure is still good, and I can see I'm getting what I want. And I can see the hairs just under the chin now, building up. On this occasion, we're doing a 2x magnification. Obviously, the higher the magnification you use, the more detail you're going to get. Well, we've taken 28 images now, and we're going to take them off to the computer and download them into the software, where we can then stack them. Right, so we've now come into the office and we've downloaded the images onto the computer, and now we need to stack them. I'm using Zareen Stacker software. Nice piece of kit, I like it. It's quick, it's simple, and it's very, very easy to use. So, a quick demonstration. We'll go through the menus first. There's not many and they're all simple. So we've got File, Add Projects, which is self-explanatory, or Add Files, sorry. That's the method I always use. If you're going to be using or starting a project but not finishing immediately, then it's better to do it as a project rather than Add Files. Then we've got the Save Projects and Save Other. Editing is for the slight retouching that this program offers. It's basic. I personally prefer to take it into Photoshop, but it is there if you want to use it, and you can then compare two images and just bring a little hair through. As I said, I tend to use Photoshop and clone or erase. That's the different types of stacks that we've got. We've got the PMax, which is a pyramid method. It's good at finding and preserving detail in low light or blurred areas. It's also good at handling overlapping structures like mats of hairs, crosshair bristles, and it avoids a slight loss of halo, which some other programs do create. Tends to increase noise and contrast, and can alter the colours a little bit, which is one of the downsides. The other method that we use is, or we could use, is the D-map. The depth map is a better job of keeping the original smooth, and it keeps the colours. However, it's not as good at finding and preserving details. So when using insects, for example, where there's a lot of hairs and bristles, I too tend to use the PMax a lot. But if you're using it for product shots, then DMAP might be better. Alternatively, if you've got something then it doesn't, take 5 minutes to do both methods, and then you could actually just merge both of them together and create an overall mega shot. Batch is a nice little feature of this program. We only created one image, but if you are looking at having created several images from different angles, you can actually batch them up into folders and then set the software, go off, make a cup of tea, have dinner, and it will go through each set and create final output images and save them back into those folders for you. So that's a nice little feature that you can leave the computer to run and get on with. And options looks at our different defaults and preferences. So let's stack this fly. So we're going to go into File and Add Files. We're going to find the images which we've got on the fly stack. And there are the 28 images that we used. We're going to select all and add them to the program. For some reason, the program always wants to resize to 3801 times 2534. I just let it do it automatically. Saves trying to get it in camera, and it doesn't take a few minutes, as you can see. Right, there's the first image that we took of the fly. As you can see, the main focal point is here on the feet and at the front of the branch log that we used. So what we're going to do is highlight all the images, and we'll stack, and we'll go with a Pmax. It'll tell us that we've got multiple images selected, or we want to stack all or not. Obviously, they're the ones we've selected. We've only done the one image, so we'll go yes. Program then has a quick look at each individual image, and as you can see, it starts at the back and will work forward. With the pyramid method, it literally is placing it on top of each other. It's looking for a set focal point on each contrast in each one. And as you can see, it's now working its way through each individual image. It's gradually stacking them up. So as you can see, it's now stacked six images. This was the base image that we started with. And as you can see, it's now adding detail as we go along. So we're now at the back of the head, and we're just picking up the forearm of this leg and the back of the rear eye. We're coming under the chin, and as it stacks forward, it will gradually build up the face, as you can see. We'll just leave this to get on, and we'll go and make a cup of tea and come back with some biscuits. Right, we're now coming up to the last couple of images, and as you can see, our fly is nearly complete. And any minute now, the detail in that eye. Ooh. As you can see, it's given us an output image down at the side here. I now need to just save output image. And I will actually put it back into the same folder so we know where to find it from. I'm going to increase the compression quality to 12 to its maximum. The file title that it comes up with is the date, and then I'm not sure if it's just random numbers or what, but obviously, and then it tells us that we've used Zerine Stacker on the Pmax. So I'll leave that for the moment, but it's up to you what you save your images as. So we'll go save and then open it in Photoshop. And there it is. So it's telling me that that's a 6 meg file. And we'll now open it up in Photoshop. Right, here we are in Photoshop with our image. And as you can see, it's quite close up at 33%. And if we increase it to 100%, you can see how close we've actually got. Eyes are looking nice and bright. The hairs aren't looking too bad either. And so, first thing I'm going to do is look at the image size. And the reason I'm going to do this is, for some reason, Zareen Stacker always converts it to a resolution of 72 pixels per inch. So I'm just going to change all the settings and stuff so that we've got a 300 dpi image that we're suitable for printing. So now we've got an image that's 12 by 8, which obviously we can expand larger if we wanted to. Okay. First of all, I'm going to take a look around the image and see what I think needs looking at. So I'm going to blow it up very, very slightly. I'm quite picky when I actually edit my images, and I do get quite distracted from little bits and pieces. So on this one, immediately I can see there's a hair going across the middle of its back, which I find distracting, so I will clone that out. I will take a look at the eyes and go in and remove some of these spots. I know it's natural, but it's just me. Same again on the top eye. We've got some bits of dust, which obviously the poor fly had on its eye anyway, but just to give the image a few more aesthetically pleasing look, I will take that out. While I'm here, you can probably see, although we're 100%, I'm now going to go in 200%, but you can see that there's been a few little mix-ups with the hairs, so we will also correct that through cloning. So I will get out the clone brush and we'll start up the top there. So I'll start on the eye first. And I'm just going over just to take those white pieces out. I'm not going to go too meticulous with this and make a slightly bigger brush, I think. And we'll go up that way. Don't like that, so I'll undo that. So we'll then come around to the side. And so this is just a brief edit to show you roughly how I do it. And we'll just knock that out slightly. Oh, okay. Sometimes you really have to play with the hairs to make them look close. And now what I'm going to do is just increase it a little, clone the bottom part of that hair and take it up a bit. Not sure if that merges better or not. So when we zoom out, it looks as though it's a single hair rather than two or three together. So that's just one of the few things that I would do with this image. And as I said to you earlier, I will clone that hair out because it is bugging me. So what I'll do is I'll take it here and then just work upwards, picking up as we go. There. So that's very briefly how I would edit an image. I'll also crop it in closer and lose a lot of this back end. So that's the basics of how I would edit this image. I'm now going to go away and finish it off properly, and we'll show you that at the end. But this has been Michelle Whitmore for the Photographer Academy, and I'll see you again soon.